All right, thank you very much, and sorry for this causing the delay.
Okay, fine. Everything is fine. Good evening to all of you. I may leave the word to Minister Nyiska Hoppen. Good evening. Microphone. Yes.
Microphone.
No, si.
Okay.
Di nuovo, si sente adesso?
Sì.
Can you hear me? Yeah? Okay. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome you on behalf of the Ambassador Anna Maria Anders, who unfortunately cannot be with us today due to the health reasons at the webinar Cybersecurity Strategy, organized by the Embassy of Poland and Diplomatia. We are really glad that despite the current epidemic situation, we can hold this online discussion on one of the very important issues of the contemporary world. I guess there is no need to state the obvious and elaborate on how the rapid development of cyberspace and modern communication channels have changed the reality we live in, or on the infinity of possibilities it has created. The development of cyberspace can be, without much exaggeration, described as a milestone comparable to taming fire. Especially science, just as in the case of fire, its great potential carries great risks. We can both get burned because of our own carelessness and fall victim to an arson. Cyber attacks are motivated by political, extremist, terrorist, and most frequently financial reasons. The cybercrime is a thriving business that, according to the Deloitte, in its most trivial manifestation, can be run for as little as $34 per month, and at the same time return $25,000. Just a couple of weeks before the outbreak of the COVID-19 pandemic, the cybersecurity ventures predicted that by 2021, cybercrime would cost the world more than $6 trillion annually, up from $3 trillion in 2015. The figure can skyrocket even further in the wake of current global chaos. Information overload and dulled vigilance. It is not without reason that the notion of a cyber pandemic is gaining ground right now. And just as in the case of the sanitary crisis, an individual act of negligence or simply bad luck can lead to thousands of new contagions. Therefore, it is of utmost importance to carry out at all levels and in all circumstances constant dialogue on cybersecurity strategies. We truly wish that today's webinar will also be able to provide valuable food for thought on the issue of counteracting cyber threats. Thank you. Grazie.
Good evening.
I think it's my, my.
Yes. Just a few. Thank you.
I'm Giovanni Castellaneta. I'm the chairman of the Diplomatia, and that's on behalf of this organization. I want to welcome all of you participants at this seminar organized together with Diplomatia and the Poland Embassy. I want to thank all the people who contributed to the organization of this event. First of all, Stefano Balsamo, our founder and great force behind the scene to carry on all these events, our secretariat, all the participants. Sorry that Ambassador Anders could not take part to this event, but she's replaced, as I see, by highest level by the Minister Council, Agnieszka Open. And so we'll, our panel is completed. I want to thank all the panelists that will give us surely a great evening. As we has been said before, cybersecurity, especially now in the pandemic momentum, shows all the importance of this subject, but with not just to limit to, let's say, tackling the COVID-19, but the cybersecurity policy has an implication in all our life, from a political, economic, security side, not forgetting the European legislation, the data protection, the golden power rules, and the, I think the need to face the attack to our system together in a European framework, together with our allies from the two sides of the Atlantic. So I think I'm sure that this evening will be of a great, give a contribution important to this subject. I wish you all the best and success. I thank you again for all the organized and best wishes to Ambassador Anders. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chairman Castellaneta. Thank you, Ambassador. And let me just give me just a few minutes to give you information regarding Diplomatia's activity and that of our twin clubs. Last October, we had a very successful hybrid event hosted by the Scuola di Polizia, with guest speaker Perfetto Vecchione, who is the director of DIS, the Department of Security Information. Yesterday, we had a very interesting webinar of our twin club, Canova, on European Union Next Generation and Recovery Fund, with speaker Irene Tinagli. She's the president of the Commission for Economic and Monetary Affairs of the European Parliament. And we had several representatives of the diplomatic world connected. I wish to point out, in fact, that Diplomatia's members have the privilege to follow also Canova Club events. Let me remind, as the last thing, Diplomatia's next appointment on November 18. The topic will be financing, investment, and feasibility on infrastructure. Dr. Scannapieco of the European Investment Bank, Dr. Dutto of Banca Intesa, hopefully a representative of the Italian government, and a couple of embassies who have been invited in the panel. Thank you for your time. I now leave the microphone to the moderator of our webinar, our member, Professor Krishi. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I was late because I thought I'd been hacked by somebody right now before the beginning of this fantastic, very interesting webinar. So thank you very much for being here. We are grateful to the ambassador and for having given us this important opportunity. And so we thank the ministry, Agnieszka Open, for hosting us today. If anybody has questions, please, you can do it on the chat by using the chat, and I will be happy to give the microphone and to pose those questions to the panel. The topic we are dealing with today is by far, I think, one of the most important topics nowadays. In this new age, I would say the digital age, every stakeholder of the market is in an infosphere, as Luciano Floridi, one of the philosophers of this time, said, in the middle of the fourth revolution, we need to utilize technology, artificial intelligence, and all the devices and solutions provided for to enhance our competition, to foster as much as we can the sustainability of the planet, from stopping hunger to solve the whole world, to solve the problems from disasters, saving the whole world from disasters. So someone has talked about green and blue, always Mr. Floridi, his philosopher. This is a green and blue period, because we have to think about both of things. But the complexity of the digital age is nevertheless in danger because of this cyber attack. Everybody of you, of course, knows that we want to explain to everybody. So any door open to implement connectivity may be a way for those who are criminals on the web and in the infospace. For this reason, in the world, everybody is thinking about cybersecurity plans. However, this is not an easy task. European Union, as our chairman Castellaneta said, has issued a directive 2016, the NIST, Network and Information Security, with some goals: upgrade the security level of the informatic system, 7 sectors: energy, transport, banks, financial markets, health, furniture, and distribution of potable water, and digital infrastructures and cloud, and many other things. Probably it will be in the vital sectors of for the internal stability, very important. So there are some needs. The Italian government, with the decree 105, substantially contained all these topics. And after some consultations, the outcome was that this regulation is fragmented. The necessity of an harmonization of the rules to sustain the single digital market. There is a need of a European governance, transnational cooperation to guarantee a European informatic resiliency and the cyber immunity. Identification of public and private operators who give out services of general interest is essential to find and to detect. So there is the talks about security by design or by default. In this period in which there is an increase of cyber attacks, 78% with the smart working, it's a very important thing. There are many questions: 5G, cybersecurity, decoupling, the phenomenon of decoupling, USA or China. So I'll introduce now the Ambassador Konitsky, the Ambassador for Cyber and Tech Affairs before the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Poland from Warsaw. He's a coordinator of all the international aspects of digital and technological security before the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And we are happy to give you the microphone and to hear what you think about. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Kishi. Thank you very much for organizing this meeting in this challenging conditions. We have to continue to work in spite of the challenging times, and especially on the cybersecurity, it's a very timely topic that we can discuss today. I apologize for technical difficulties. I have had to join the meeting this evening, and it is my honor and privilege to speak to the honorable audience today, gathered together by the Embassy of Poland and Diplomatia, which is a collection of honorable and important people in Italian society. So thank you for that. It was already mentioned the importance of the cyberspace in the current times, and the importance of the cyberspace is growing significantly over the last few years. Actually, the most frequently discussed topics like 5G or even wider information and telecommunication technologies are in fact only tools for something more important. These are tools for the industrial revolution that we're facing now, the revolution which is called Industry 4.0, or many different names in media and in different discussions, but it's indeed a revolution, because it will be not a development but a jump into new era of industry, and as it follows, a new era of economy based of breaking through technologies which are being currently developed. We are talking about artificial intelligence here, we are talking about Internet of Things, something that may be more common, is more common to the people: 3D printing, quantum physics applied to the computers and technology, smart cities, etc. This breaking through technologies are going to elevate the economy and industry to a new level. And we are observing and to a degree participating in the global race, who is going to lead this economy of the new era. So for several years, not only governments, but also societies in the world are witnessing the competition between the leading powers of the world, between the USA and China, which were competitors and sometimes at the almost stayed close to the war for the primacy in this race. Because whoever is going to lead this race and win this race will be actually setting up the conditions for the future economy development. And that's why it is so important. And I think that this process that we are observing for several years has made us realize the importance of these processes which are taking place in technology and cyberspace, but also they are making us to ask questions. Where is the place of Europe in all of this? Or quo vadis Europe, Europa, and what we shall do in this under these conditions, what we can define as our interest, and which steps we can take to achieve this interest. On the level of the wider population, I think the latest developments related to the pandemic of COVID-19 made everyone and individual realize the importance of cyberspace and the importance of cybersecurity. On the level of individual people, on the level of homes, families and companies, everybody realized the importance of the cyber space and also cybersecurity. In the times of this pandemic, we are observing the increased activities of cybercrime. There's a increased number of malicious activities in the cyberspace of different character. Maybe on the individual level, the most common fact is the cybercrime that people are being faced with on their activities like shopping, banking, etc. But we also observe the more coordinated, more focused, and more advanced cyber attacks targeting public and local and central institutions in the governments and societies, public infrastructure, critical infrastructure, including even health infrastructure. We've been witnessing attacks on the health system in the times of the global pandemic, which of course is a very malicious activities. And that is a new fact that we are facing increasingly in the last year. And another part of the cyber malicious activities that we are facing is increased disinformation campaigns. The pandemic itself became a target and the tool of the disinformation campaigns carried out by state and non-state actors, sometimes by non-state proxies to the state actors. And the disinformation in times of the society, which is living on media, living on social media, and functioning online for many hours every day, is also a very important challenge and threat to the stability of the functioning of our societies. So in that conditions that we have described, this is more understandable that importance of the cybersecurity has been better realized and has been put higher on the agenda. That can be seen in different formats. Myself, I'm working 12 to 16 hours every day. And that is becoming a bit challenging because I could say that in the beginning of pandemic reality, we have to learn how to switch from live face-to-face meeting to using the online tools. And that was a little bit of a moment, maybe in March, beginning of April, that things were going slowing down. But once we've learned how to use these tools, it became eruption. It became an eruption of the activities online. And in my daily life, I'm participating in at least 3 or 4 VTCs, meetings, consultations, conferences on our national level, interagency level, bilateral level, EU level, NATO level, OECD level, and United Nations level. Some of them actually overlapping because now we can do it next to each other. Like in the past, you cannot be in the same time in New York or Geneva or Vienna or Roma or Warsawia, but now you can. So it's just switching the multiply monitors and tools that we have all around us on the desks, and we jump from one meeting to another. This number of meetings, of course, is also causing the challenges to the security of the meetings. There is only limited level of the security that we can assume in these meetings. So in fact, the face-to-face meetings were never replaced in the diplomatic world by the cyber meetings or the online meetings. But this is the reality we have to deal with. And as a result, the activity online and the importance of the security of the activities online became very important. I know that Italy is attaching a lot of importance to that. Even in the peak of the first wave of pandemic in Italy, and in April, the Italian ambassador for cybersecurity, Laura Capati, has been elevated. She got a bigger team because your government understands the importance of this issues. So what is the major levels in which we are dealing with the security challenges and threats currently in Europe? I would like to mention 3 before concluding. The first is the cyber attacks as they're happening and our response to those cyber attacks, which are recognized and identified and assigned to an actor standing behind them. I think this is very important, and in these times, the European Union has introduced and implemented for the first time cyber sanctions on July 30. We have in place cyber diplomacy toolbox. This is the instrument of resilience that has been developed within the European Union over the last few years, but the first practical usage of the instrument took place on July 30, when the first package of cyber sanction was introduced against the individuals and entities from 3 countries, from Russia, China, and North Korea. And the second time it has happened a week ago, exactly Thursday, a week ago, the second package identifying attackers on the German Bundestag has been implemented into the EU Council decisions, and the sanctions became reality. Of course, sanctions are not going to stop attacks. Sanctions are not going to resolve the problems of the attacks. But I think it is an important instrument because it shows the EU as a whole is capable of taking actions in assigning the attacks, in pointing them out to the and to taking restrictive measures against the people and the entities standing behind these attacks. So it's sending hopefully strong signal that those who are attacked can be identified, publicly named, labeled, and restricted. So this is the first level. On the second level, I'd say it's what we need to do for the current developments in the technology. I started by saying that 5G communication is only a tool of a wider process of industrial revolution, but at this moment, 5G is a very important tool. It will change completely the information flows, it would allow a number of technologies to be implemented on a wide scale, like Internet of Things, independent driving, etc. That's why this is so important. And now Europe and in parallel NATO in the same time has recognized the importance of the security of the 5G as we are going to develop it now, or as we are developing it now. The EU has come up with a specific tools to take this or to face these challenges. It has been announced in January this year and took form of the EU 5G Security Toolbox. The toolbox is providing a number of measures for the member states to be implemented to increase our safety and security of the 5G networks that are being currently built and developed. The similar activities, not so unified as in the EU, but also discussed widely in details, are taking place within NATO, how to secure the communication of the NATO. And this is also very important. But coming back to the EU, the EU toolbox has been given to the states and the countries. The member states had to report on the implementation of that toolbox in the middle of the year, in July. The report has been published. And now on the individual level of the member states, this toolbox recommendations are being implemented. As we speak now, we have in Poland concluding process of reviewing our national cybersecurity system law. This law will include the number of the toolbox recommendations into our national legislation system. There is a number of them. I'm not going to go into details, but the important one is to verify the suppliers of technology, suppliers of equipment, services, and software that is being used for the 5G networks, but not only for the 5G networks, but in general for the ICTs. And I think this solutions or similar solutions are being implemented and will be implemented in all other EU members in each country individually, on taking into account the legal structure of the country. But we shall end up next year with the legal infrastructure and the framework for all member states to provide for more secure and independent from malicious influences from outside communication networks. And the third and the last level, which I wanted to mention here, is much longer, long-term oriented. In this dynamic changing situation that I have mentioned at the beginning, the rivalry between the leading powers of the world, the question is for the Europeans, where is our place in the future? What are our alliances? What is their power? How much we can rely on them. And we are definitely think that we should strengthen the existing solutions we have in place, like NATO. I think NATO importance is not diminishing in the current world. Unfortunately, the current world is not much safer world as it was 10 or 15 years ago. The end of communism did not resulted in elimination of the evil sources in the world, and we cannot sleep quite safely believing that the world is going to be safe to all of us in Europe, and the only problems may happen somewhere in the third countries, somewhere far away from Europe. No, unfortunately, this is not the fact. So we need to really take efforts and spend our security, including through NATO, but not limited to NATO. There is a lot of discussions that Europe as a whole should look in the future to increase the autonomy of Europe, the increase self-sufficiency and sovereignty of Europe. In the EU Council conclusions from the 1st, 2nd of October, so the beginning of this month, The notion of sovereignty, European sovereignty in the context of cyberspace has been endorsed. And this is not against the transatlantic relations. This is in parallel to the transatlantic relations. In the longer term, we have to build in Europe more independence, because the pandemic also showed that it was the whole Europe were dependent in number of sectors on supplies from the third countries. And even without any evil intentions from these countries, simply because of the scarcity of goods, were not capable to supply necessary means to fight the pandemic. And because not somebody wanted to make it more difficult for us, but because we were so much dependent. That is a result of globalization. That is not necessarily a bad thing. I'm not advocating isolation of Europe or putting up restrictions in the free trade, not at all. We should look into cooperation, free trade, also research cooperation with our major partners, but in the same time, the importance of our self-sufficiency in Europe has been raised to a higher level in the strategic discussions. And Europe has taken this decision to start the process of building our self-sufficiency. And one of the results, and this is my final part of the presentation here,
Ambassador, we have time constraints.
Sorry for that. The last element I wanted to mention here is that we understood that we have to develop more and more intra-European cooperation to increase our technological capabilities, including in cyberspace. And as we speak currently, the European Union is in the process, and us as the member states, is in the process of creating the European Cybersecurity Industrial Technologies and Research Competence Center. This competence center will be an important element to help research and development and implementation of new technologies, which are a condition for building our self-sufficiency in cyberspace in Europe. And this is a topic which I was devoted to very much recently. I am currently, because Poland is a candidate to host this center. We are actually currently discussing, including with the Italian government, why Poland is the best place to place it in the Europe, because we have a good IT sector environment in Europe. But this is, regardless of our national wish to host it, this is a very important element of a long-term solution. Sanctions is now. 5G security is coming soon. But increasing our European capabilities to develop new technologies is a longer-term solution that we need in Europe, and is very important to increase the security and stability of cyberspace from the European perspective. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador, for having given us this picture, very clear picture of all the activities that we are all to do, and to have given us also a hope that the globalization that we liked a lot is still on, nevertheless, with the need to be sovereign in our countries and to be able to produce our needs anyhow, being global through the computers and be more global through the computers, but with the need of being self-sufficient without breaking any treaty. Now I would like to give the microphone to Dr. Massimo Tedeschi, Chief Technical Officer of the Cybersecurity Division of Leonardo. He's a member, and welcome to talk. Thank you very much, Massimo.
Thank you to you. I hope that you can listen to me, because I also have some problems for technical connection with the WebEx. Maybe that we are under the same kind of attacks. you professor says, also the ambassador says, we have changed our habits from the new pandemic for smart working, because we can see that our infrastructure, company infrastructure or public organization infrastructure, have been take part in our domestic perimeters. We have to use domestic devices like router like private connection that can be easily used by hackers for acquiring information and perhaps try to break our security perimeters. But as you can imagine, it's, the threats is changes, it adaptive threats that changed during the time on time. We have seen how also the tools that can try to protect our infrastructure changed during the years. And also a company like Leonardo have tried to change the approach for this kind of threats by understanding the threats. We think that should be effective and useful for protecting our critical infrastructure to understand the threats by analyzing the adversary, the hostile actors approach, the crew, the interest of the state sponsorship hackers, or perhaps also economic hackers that try to get our information, or perhaps gain money. And this approach can be useful, integrated by analyzing the capabilities, the malware, the tools, the modus operandi of these actors that try to gather information from our infrastructure, or perhaps understanding the infrastructure of attacks, the network, the hostile approach that they use for having the capability of understanding our infrastructure, and the most important part is the victims. Sometimes we also talk about sanctions, and one of the problems is that understanding is possible to make an attribution of an attack, but it's a game of mirrors, so it's very difficult to have an attribution of a cyber attack. But understanding the motivation, the needs, the information that this kind of actors try to put on table to acquire information can be useful for understanding the intention and try to protect. It's very interesting how also this kind of threats is adaptive, because we see that normally the economic motivation that make these actors working on the cyber scenario have changed. Usually a ransomware is a kind of attack that is aimed to acquire immediately the control of the PC and ask for a ransom to the victims. But we have seen some cases, especially oriented on the university world, when these hostile actors have tried to understand which will be the more valuable asset that can be under attack. For example, in this university, they understand weeks before which will be the most valuable asset, like courses or perhaps the list of students that have just subscribed to the courses, and attack exactly the server that contains the information. So we can see that it's not only an approach based on economic and a large mass acquisition of information, but it's very shaped, very tailored attack where you can see an intelligence activity more effective. This is very important, and we think that for analyzing this kind of threats should be very useful to increase our cybersecurity knowledge base capability, understanding this kind of information. And as you said before, it should be very interested about sharing this information in EU level, perhaps also with the Center for Exchanges in for industrial world, or perhaps also other kind of research in the EU level. But it's very interesting about how we can try to protect the supply chain, because we can see that all the companies, especially in Italy, where we got a lot of very small companies that provide some solution for our world, for our industrial day by day work, have many of the infrastructure not protected. So you have to control this kind of infrastructure also by yourself, trying to have a cyber resilience and cyber security by design approach. It's very interesting how we build, as Leonardo, helicopters, but now it seems more easy to take down an helicopter more than a Stinger missile than with a USBK when you're updating the firmware of the helicopter itself, and you cannot make a very, very deep control of the supply chain of this information. So we can try to have a wall approach, 360 degrees monitoring controlling model. And it's very interesting also the initiative of the Italian government, as you also Professor Crisci said before, for the Law Decree 105 and the 2019 for the perimeter, national perimeter security, where it's also introduced a new model of a National Center of Certification and Validation, CVCN in Italy. It's a supervisor body under the control of the Ministry of Economic Development, and the old entities included in perimeter and all the central purchasing bodies for public procurement with intention to purchase ICT equipment must communicate to CVCN a list of all components that they wish to introduce in their architecture, also with an attachment of risk analysis based on its intended use. So the same is CVCN, the National Center for Certification and Validation, will also elaborate cybersecurity certification scheme in accordance also with ENISA standard. So in the event that the actual one was not sufficient adequate to protect national security and to be complied with also the adaptive threats that we have to cope with. So in this term, we think that should be a very large approach to the cybersecurity, try to understand, to have a cyber information superiority to try to manage this kind of information. It should be very effective if we can try to share this cyber knowledge between our countries, especially in Europe. Try together to acquire this autonomy in terms of cyber security. I don't think that we are able to substitute our partners in IT components, but we have to make control of the data and also the product that they are on our infrastructure, they build our infrastructure and our systems. Thank you to you.
Thank you very much, Massimo. It was very clear, short, and very interesting. And the supply chain problems is problem is a very important problem, because everything would stop without with this supply chain problem. And the Italian approach has been very good. The control of data is very important as well. So let me give microphone to Mr. Dr. Federico Hornbostel, is president of GPI Posca. GPI has been created in 1988 by Fausto Marzana. Is been supplying innovative information technologies to the public administration, social affairs entities, and the national health system for more than 30 years. The company's goal is to grasp the innovation process, improve the digitalization process, and the organization of its client companies, providing tailored services, technology, and software. For the past 4 years, the group has grown through the acquisition of companies in the field, technologies, services, and with similar complementary business in Italy and abroad, and over 5,000 employees distributed throughout the national territory and branches in Europe. Thank you very much, Mr. Hornbostel. Please speak. Your microphone, please.
Sorry. Okay, now it's fine. Hello, everyone, and thanks for the invitation. Of course, thanks to the Polish Embassy in Italy, to Diplomatia. So you explained very well who are GPI Group. I'm the president of GPI Posca. GPI Posca is a company of GPI Group, very huge Italian and international group at the same times. The most important market for us is healthcare, and then healthcare solutions, but not only, because we have a small company in Italy and even in Poland for payment solutions. And then you can understand that cybersecurity for us it's a very, very important topic for both market, for healthcare, and even maybe more in the payment solution. Okay, in a few minutes, it's not easy to explain what GPI does for cyber security. But therefore, I want to think about our innovation solutions for telemedicine, which is very important, especially in the pandemic period. I think it's real. In Poland, we are waiting to be able to present shortly this solution to the Ministry of Health and even to the Department of Health in the Mazovian region. Through our embassy, through the Italian embassy in Warsaw. As you can imagine, cybersecurity in telemedicine is very important because we monitor many, many, and many vital parameters of home patients. Of course, I don't have time to give a full presentation, maybe because I'm not a technician. But for me, about our choices, two things are very important. Two things are most important. The first one is that we adopted cloud implementation. Cloud implementation implementation modules with focusing on suppliers. But what kind of suppliers? The suppliers who provide the best guarantee of security and compliance. For example, one important company of Amazon, AWS. This company certified the data center as a resident in the European Union and then therefore compliant with the standard. The first thing. The second thing at the application level, in relation to the topic of virtual care, for example, I don't know, television, telepresence, teleconsultation, and so on. These are peer-to-peer solutions. But our competitors, what do? They use third-party server solutions, like Cisco, Skype, I don't know what. Probably for speed, maybe just for speed. But as you can imagine, this means they lose control over the data. And then for us, it's a crazy choice. GPI chose a different solution. We have developed all the components, and therefore we have complete control not only of the data flow, but even of the evolution of the solutions. And then I can say for GPI, the cybersecurity is the first thing. When we study, when we develop, when we have one evolution of the solutions. And all our solutions are very innovative, even for the cybersecurity. Okay, few minutes, 2 minutes, very fast. I think it's enough. And then thank a lot for your attention.
Thank you very much. It's very interesting, your presentation and what your company does, because this implementation and to be aware of who supplies the security and to treat only with those people, it's a very, if I understood well, it's a very interesting thing in the control, in those segmentation of control in the study stage, in the developing stage, in the evolution, and following all over. It's a very interesting thing. Thank you very much. I will now give the microphone to Mr. Dr. Luciano Ricci, Sales Innovation Partnership and M&A Director of Vantea Smart. Vantea Smart is very active in the Italian IT landscape, is specialized in cybersecurity, combining consultancy in the field of system integration and software development, project development, products, and consultancy on Java. Nets and business intelligence complete this portfolio. Vantea Smart supports the customers throughout the digital transformation cycle, helping them in process change, in infrastructural and product innovation, thus providing specialized and structured professional services with relevant connections in the banking and insurance fields, telecommunications, oil and gas, manufacturing industry, and the small and medium business world. It operates throughout in the Italian market. Thank you very much, Luciano, please.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I just would like to go back to talk about the drivers that are moving the cybersecurity to change again paradigm. In these times of challenges, are blowing the fastest changes in the evolution of specific processes and industries. What we are facing right now with this epidemic is not only a step forward to a global health system, but a strong improvement in processes to have the response to an acceleration in the biology industry to study and prepare the vaccine. But in this period, in the COVID era, we change a lot of things. We change our lives. We change our way to buy food, clothes, and goods. And we change our way to participate to a webinar, to a conference like this. We change our way to work. Smart working has become official, even in countries where it was impossible to think about it till now. And more, all of these changes will impact on our town's future organizational layout. Even in a fast-growing market such as the cybersecurity industry, we are facing a new deep change of paradigm. It seems to be yesterday when there was the evolution from the reaction paradigm to a proactive one. The digital perimeter of our companies, as Leonardo talked about it before, were to position the countermeasure to control unauthorized accesses or to react to cyber attacks now seems to be fading away. Which is our castle to defend if we are moving application to the cloud and people to remote working? This is the question right now. We have to defend the data of our applications and the digital identities of our users, both employees and customers. Till now, we implemented a proactive approach through security operational centers to learn from the countermeasures collected data, and through security orchestration, automation, and response systems to learn from the incident knowledge base. We implemented even tools to learn our normal model across the entire digital business responding to threats. These smart tools work on machine learning and artificial intelligence algorithms. But let's have a look at what happened the day after the lockdown in March, when all our normal models have blown away, and they were blown away from Friday night to Monday morning. Most of the reaction of models, of these tools, were turned off, simply turned off, because there was a dramatic change from our more normal model, 90% is local traffic, to the new normal. 90% is remote traffic. The most popular interpretation of this change by these tools was a distributed denial of service attack. So the cybersecurity industry is changing approach towards an adaptive security paradigm, where there is an inside simulation of all the possible changes of our business models. In this new paradigm, machine learning and artificial intelligence algorithms consider all the changes in our habits and try to recognize them in a shorter time. In addition, there's the possibility to the human to help to weight the changes in the security rules and policies. In Vantea, we try to help our customers to face these challenges in the day-by-day cybersecurity world. We work with our customers to define their cybersecurity posture, to learn from the incidents, and to implement security by design, security by default processes in the service creation and software development cycles.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Luciano, thank you very much for your presentation. And now I think that this is the time for questions, but questions, we don't have questions. And so I will invite Francesco Ago, our president and chairman, vice president of Diplomatia, to say some things, recapping all the what we have said so far, and say goodbye. Thank you, Francesco. Do you hear us?
Yes, yes, I can hear you now. I was just trying to activate the audio. Authorities, ladies and gentlemen, I take this the microphone to thank the ambassador of Poland, who has organized this event with us and who has brought to the table such important and competent person as Mr. Chomicki, to whom goes our gratitude for his contribution to the debate. I'm also very happy for the participation of many embassies in Italy, which I want to mention: Austria, Bulgaria, France, Japan, Ireland, Korea, Portugal, Romania, South Africa, and Hungary. This means that there is a lot of interest around the world for the presentation and for the team. Let me add that the topic of the speech tonight is so interesting and so hot that we will necessarily continue to deepen and to organize events and discussions, also maybe with the round tables, because we believe that there is interest and there is a need for further contribution. This is clearly emerged from the discussion tonight. Of course, if anybody is interested to participate, we will welcome and we invite to contact us. I don't want to take additional time, and therefore also on behalf of Stefano Balsamo, who was mentioned before but who could not participate, I wish to all of you a very pleasant evening, and bye bye and see you on our further events.
Thank you very much, Francesco. Stefano Balsamo would be happy because we are sharp in 1 hour. We closed the meeting as usual. Thank you very much to everybody for being here, and then we hope to see you soon again on this topic and other things, even helping each other in this topics. Thank you. Bye bye. So I close.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, Ambassador.
Thank you so much. Bye bye. Thank you. Grazie mille.
Grazie.
Bye.